Hi all, welcome you all to the webinar on multi-regional API management. This is the first webinar of the webinar series on multi-regional API management. I am Samita Chaturanga, Associate Technical Lead in WSO2, and Mustaq Rumi, who is an Associate Technical Lead in WSO2, will also join me to conduct this webinar. So before starting the webinar, we have some announcement to give you. First one is that you can post questions during this session, and we will answer them at the end of the webinar in the Q&A session. And we will share the slides and the recording of this webinar to all the participants after the webinar within 24 hours. Okay, in this webinar, we will discuss the fundamentals of multi-regional and multi-data center API management deployments. Here you can see the agenda of this webinar. We'll first discuss the challenges in on-premise API management. Then we'll describe what is this multi-regional API management and multi-data center API management. Then we will elaborate why we should go for multi-regional or multi-DC API management solutions with regards to pros and cons of it. Then we will dive deep into the general patterns of multi-regional deployments. And next, we will do a demo with the real-world use case, and finally discuss on the concerns regarding rate limiting and analytics. Okay, so what are the challenges in on-premise API management? These are the major challenges we face in traditional on-premise API management deployment. Latency, machine failures, data center outages, and demand for more availability. I will describe each of these aspects in the next slide. So before going on to that, let's clarify what is a data center and what is a region. A data center is a physical group of network computer servers typically used by organizations for the remote storage, processing, or distribution of large amounts of data. A region is a geographical location with a collection of physical data centers in that region. Every region is physically isolated and they are independent from each other in terms of location, power, network, and so on. Okay, let's talk about the challenge about the latency. As mentioned previously, regions are residing in separate geographical locations. Generally, a region might represent a state, country, or continent. For global applications and systems, mostly it will be a continent or a region on the world. As you see in this diagram, region 1 represents USA and the region 2 represents the APAC region. The API Manager runtime instance is residing in the APAC region, but there are applications that consume the APIs in the API Manager gateway within both USA region and the APAC region. So in this case, client applications in USA region will face a considerable network latency, since the traffic will need to propagate through a distant geographical area. Higher the latency, the efficiency of the overall system gets dictated. Client application in the APAC region won't face such a latency, since the API gateway resides within its region itself. So there should be a solution for this high latency related issue of API invocations in between regions. Client applications in USA region should be able to invoke the APIs as efficiently by for APAC region applications. The next challenge of on-premise API management deployments are the machine failures and data center outages. In the left-hand side, you can see a simple architectural diagram of a distributed API management solution with multiple nodes and components. There, assume the key manager instance gets down due to machine failure. Maybe there are multiple key manager nodes configured for high availability. But still, what happens if both of those key manager nodes get down due to machine failures? Then the key management functionalities of overall runtime system will cease working. API invocations which choose opaque OAuth tokens will not work as key validation component is down. Then in the right hand side, you can see that the whole deployment in the data center has gone down. Then the complete system functionality will cease working, irrespective that there might be multiple HA nodes deployed for each component. These types of failures should be expected in the production deployment and needs to be handled gracefully. Okay, so what about the demand for more availability? The availability of a system is critical for many application domains in today's world. Unavailability of a system, even for a minute, can be highly critical for such applications. So the developers of those applications prominently concentrate on the high availability of their API management solutions. Assume if eBay, Facebook, or Twitter gets completely down for an hour. It affects critically for their related business processes, commercial use cases, and even that will badly impact on the reputation and their brand name. So the demand of highest possibility of availability has become a valuable factor in today's API management market. So up to now, we discussed the major challenges of traditional on-premise API management deployments. So what are the solutions to win these challenges? Multi-regional and multi-data center concept is there to address these. So let's clarify what these concepts and models are about. As opposed to the traditional on-premise single region and single DC based deployments, it is possible to use multiple regions and multiple data centers. Based on the nature of the system, we can set up multiple regions, one in US, one in Africa, one in South America, Asia, Europe, Australia, likewise. We can set up the API management deployment across the globe. That is the decision on how to distinguish regions can be taken based on the type of application and businesses the system is incorporated. Then we can set up multiple data centers within each region too, according to the nature of the requirement. So this diagram illustrates a simple WS2 API manager deployment of two regions, each containing single data center. Each data center contains two all-in-one WS2 API manager nodes. So this deployment has guaranteed HA in each data center by having two active API manager nodes. And this has come over the previously mentioned concerns by having two data centers and two regions. Now let's discuss why do we need multi-regional or multi-DC API manager deployment patterns. So let's focus on the pros and cons of this multi-regional model so that you will understand what you can use and when you can. Let's discuss about the pros first. Via multi-regional model, it is possible to partition traffic among regions. As in this diagram, if there is no region or DC by separation, assume the sole DC receives 6 API requests per second. But if we re-architect the deployment to have two data centers or two regions, then each DC or region will get 3 requests per second. So the traffic each node has to handle has been reduced and partitioned across two DCs. This is what we call as traffic partitioning. And using multi-regional and multi-DC deployments, it is possible to increase the availability of the system. If one region gets down, there's another region up and running to serve the traffic. Even if one DC in single region gets down, there are other DCs to handle the traffic within the region. Today's enterprises focus highly on this availability, and there is this concept called having more lines. When the availability increases, the percentage of duration that the system is available gets increased too. Usually the availability is expected to have at least 99%, and it is better to have 99.9% and 99.99% and likewise. So generally, having more lines in the availability percentage is better. And the other advantage is disaster recovery. If the whole deployment gets down due to a disaster, maybe a natural disaster, software failure, hardware failure, power failure, and likewise, it reduces latency for regional access. It also supports to align with the regional regulatory enforcements conveniently. And it also avoids the cloud vendor locking. Cloud vendor locking is a scenario that enterprises have to restrict to particular cloud vendor to get infrastructure services. But when there are multiple data centers and regions, they have the flexibility to use multiple cloud vendors for their deployments. This is supported by WS2 API Manager. And there are a few disadvantages that you should focus with before adapting a multi-regional API management deployment. They are high complexity, high cost, higher cost, requirement for additional efforts to set up deployments and maintenance overhead. Now we will take a look into some deployment patterns that can be used for multi-DC and multi-regional deployments. So we will be taking you through 5 patterns, out of which 3 of them are multi-DC and the other 2 are multi-regional deployments. First, let's have a look at the first deployment pattern, which is active-passive all-in-one deployment. To obtain high availability with the minimum number of nodes, you need to have at least 2 API Manager all-in-one nodes. These API Manager nodes should be connected to the same database. So for simplicity, we have named the database as the API DB, but actually it can be divided into shared DB and API DB. And there are also 2 WS2 API Manager analytics nodes too in the DC with analytics database. Both the DCs have such an analytics server deployment. Let's take a look at the events labeled with circled A, B, and C letters in this diagram. Event A is that all tables of API DB of DC1 should be replicated to DC2 via database replication. Event B is that all tables of analytics DB of DC1 should be replicated to DC2 via database replication. Event C illustrates that DC1 to DC2 shared file system should be replicated using rsync, NFS, or any other file system replication mechanism. So to seamlessly work in active-passive mode, you need to have a global load balancer to control traffic routing. And when the active DC fails, traffic should be routed to the passive DC. We can have 2 options to revive the failed DC. Option 1 is that database and the file system of the failed DC should be fully synced before making it an active DC again. Option 2, the failed active DC can be brought up as passive, and the database replication and rsync should be reversed. Okay, now we will move on to the second deployment pattern, which is active passive with separate gateway and key manager deployment. When considering a scalable architecture, a separate gateway and key manager nodes with publisher, admin, and dev portal with the traffic manager node is the recommended pattern. There are three events that need to be carried out to sync data center 1 to data center 2 as highlighted in this diagram. In the event named as A, all the tables of API and DB of DC1 should be replicated to DC2 via database replication. In the event named as B, all the tables of analytics DB of DC1 should be replicated to DC2 via database replication. In the event named as C, DC1 to DC2 shared file system for APIs should be replicated using rsync or any other file system replication mechanism. And in the event named as D, DC1 to DC2 shared file system for throttling policies should be replicated using rsync or any other file system replication mechanism. The next pattern is active passive fully distributed deployment. A fully distributed deployment provides more scalability and isolation among the different API manager profiles. The difference between a fully distributed versus separate key manager and gateway deployment pattern is running dedicated publisher, view portal, and traffic manager nodes. Since we are running a separate publisher to traffic manager and publisher to gateway calls should be routed via a load balancer. This will help to avoid a single point of failures. There are three events that need to be carried out to sync data center 1 to data center 2 as highlighted in the diagram. In the event mentioned as A, all tables of API and DB, including user manager DB and registry DB of DC1 should be replicated to DC2 via database replication. In the event mentioned as B, all tables of analytics DB of DC1 should be replicated to DC2 via database replication. And in the event mentioned as C, DC1 to DC2 shared file system for APIs should be replicated using rsync or any other file system replication mechanism. And in the event mentioned as D, DC1 to DC2 shared file system for throttling policies should be replicated using rsync or any other file system replication mechanism. So I discussed three multi-DC deployment patterns, and Mustafa will take over from here and start with multi-regional deployment patterns.
Thank you, Samita. So yes, let's move on with this slide. So now we will look at two of the multi-regional deployments. First one deploys all the APIs in all the regions. The key difference between a multi-regional and a multi-data center is that regional data centers can be fully isolated with large distances between them, as they would generally be across different countries or continents. Therefore, traffic partitioning will provide tremendous benefits in a multi-regional deployment scenario. Regional traffic can be routed to the nearest region, and it will give low latency and fast access to the APIs, given that backend services are also deployed in the region. Let us take a detailed look of synchronization across the region as highlighted in the diagram with circle letters. If we take a look at A, all tables of APIMDB of region 1 should be replicated to region 2 via database replication. And in B, region 1 to region 2 shared file system for APIs should be replicated using rsync or any file system replication mechanism. If we take a look at C, region 1 to region 2 shared file system, and this is for throttling policies, should be replicated using rsync or any other file system replication. If we take a look at D, API analytics traffic should be published to the master region. Analytics is stateful, and therefore we cannot do local or regional analyzing and merges the results unless you have partition key in the API analytics data. Some other reasons are, some analytics need to get all API analytics data to analyze and provide accurate decisions. Publisher, store, admin app have presentation layer of these analytics. Next, we will look at a multi-region deployment pattern which deploys selected APIs in selected regions. In some use cases, we need to push selected APIs to particular regions. API management can be done in a master region and access to these APIs can be regionalized. In such a scenario, this multi-regional deployment will help. In this scenario too, we have the same assumption that API traffic will be partitioned according to regions. Let us take a detailed look of the synchronization across the regions. One important note is that since we have selectively pushed APIs to regional gateways, there is no need to sync all API files across regions. All the processes will be similar to the previous deployment except for step D highlighted in the diagram, and that is selected APIs should be pushed to region 1 to region 2. When you add an external gateway to the publisher, it will appear in the API publishing window. Then from the publisher node, initiate an API call to the regional gateway to create the API files in the regional gateway file system. Those are some of the multi-DC and multi-regional deployment patterns that we wanted to share. Now, let's have a demo session with a simple multi-regional deployment using API manager instances and micro gateway instances. Having micro gateway instances would make sure that it is fully independent from the key manager component as it uses JWT tokens. This will be somewhat similar to the last deployment pattern we discussed in the previous slide. In this demo, we use a simple use case of a bank called ABC Bank, which has customers all around the world. So this will be the customized pattern that we will be using for this demo. The ABC Bank will have API Manager deployed in two regions, namely the APAC region and the US region. In the APAC region, it will have two API Manager instances. Publisher, developer portal, key manager, and traffic manager will be included in each instance. And this will be fronted by a load balancer of which the host name is abcbank.apn.com. Apart from that, this region will have two micro gateways fronted by a load balancer with a host name called abcbankrg1ng.apn.com and a database as well. In the US region, it will only have two micro gateways fronted by a load balancer with a host name called abcbankrg2.apm.com. This is to show that the traffic will be partitioned according to the region. The ABC Bank will have two APIs called Exchange Rates API. This will give the latest exchange rates of the currencies, and Loan Details API. This will give the loan details such as the term and the rate. The Exchange Rates API will be available in both the regions, whereas the Loan Details API will be available in the US region only. This is because the bank only facilitates loan in the US region. Let's see how we can achieve this using the above deployment in the demo. So first, let's log into the admin WSO2's admin portal. And see how we can add the micro gateway labels according to region in this case. So as you can see, we have added a label called APAC region, and the host name of the LB in that particular region, we have mentioned it as the gateway host, and that is the abcbankrg1ng.apn.com. Similarly, we have added a label for the US region as well, with the host name of the LP for the US region, and it is named as abcbankrg2ng.apn.com. So now let's move on to the WSO2 API Manager Publisher Portal. where we have created, so for we have created two APIs, and as mentioned in the slides, so one is the exchange rates API and the other one is loan details API. If we go into the exchange rate API and if we go to the environment section, you can see that this API, we have for this API we have selected both the regions, the APAC region and the US region, so that this exchange rates API will be available in the both the regions. And if we take a look at the loan details API, and if you go to the environment section, we allow this particular API in the US region only. So now let's look at the dev portal, where we have this new application called the new app, have subscriptions for both these APIs. So in order to save time, I have already generated the tokens for this subscription. And now let's take a look at how we can incorporate these micro gateway labels and create the micro gateway projects. So this will be done in the my local machine using the WSO2 API Manager micro gateway toolkit. So first we need to initialize a project for a particular region in this case. So I have already initiated a project called APAC project, and the next step would be to import the label which we mentioned in the admin portal API as the APAC region, and we need to give the APAC the initialized project name in the previous step. So as you can see, this will import the APIs related to this particular APAC region. So we will have to give the username and the password in order to access the REST API of the API manager node, and we will have to give the URL as well. So as you can see, the exchange rates API has been imported for this particular project. So as I mentioned earlier, the APAC region will only have the exchange rates API. So once this is imported, we will have to build this APAC project so that it will give a jar file in order to run the micro gateway runtime. So as this runs, so we will have to do the same thing for the US region as well in a similar manner. So let's wait for the jar to be built. So if we take a look at the next steps, what we need to do is we need to get this jar and put it in the where the micro gateway runtime is located, and we need to try and start the runtime with this particular jar. In order to make this simple, so I have already copied the APAC project in the APAC region micro gateways. So I have already logged into the APAC region, one of the APAC region micro gateway instances. And let's see where I have placed the jar. So as you can see, the APAC project jar has been moved to this particular instance. And in order to start the micro gateway runtime using the APAC project jar, so we can give this particular command and the jar file. So this nohub command will make sure that this process runs in the background. So if we take a look at the log file, the micro gateway will be started. So in a similar fashion, we will have to do the same thing for the US region micro gateways as well. So I have already done the same thing in the APAC region micro gateway, the other instance of the APAC region micro gateway. So, and the micro gateway runtimes are up and running. So now let's try to access the APIs that we have created using the load balancer in two different regions. So I have already created the curl command with the generated JWT token. So let's try to first access the exchange rates API in the US region. So as you can see, we have pointed to the load balancer of the US region, that is abcbank.rg2ng.apm.com. So as you can see, we have got the successful response for the US region. And this is for the exchange rates API. Now let's try to invoke the loan details API in the same US region. So here also we have got a successful response with the details, the duration and respective rates for that particular loan. So as you can see, both the APIs which we have incorporated in the label are accessible in this US region's micro gateway. So now let's try to access the same APIs in the APAC region as well. So as you can see, I'm accessing the load balancer in the APAC region, which is the ABC Bank rg1ng.apm.com. So as you can see, the exchange rates API is also accessible in the APAC region. So if we take a look at the loan details API and if we try to access it in the APAC region, ideally this should not be able to, the user should not be able to access this API in the APAC region. So as you can see, there is a error message saying no matching service found for this part. So that should be the expected behavior since this loan bank API is not exposed in the APAC region. Okay, so that's all for the demo. That's all we have for the demo. Now let's have a look at some drawbacks of the deployment we used for the demo. The first issue is that someone might face is the accuracy of the rate limiting or throttling. As you can see in the diagram, the micro gateways in the US region will publish throttling data to the APIM instances in the APAC region. This will result in some delays in publishing the throttling data. Hence, this will lead to inaccuracy of the API throttling limit. For example, if the throttling limit is set to 100 requests per second for an API, the throttle out might not happen exactly at 100 requests. Rather, it might throttle out after 120 requests, which may have a high impact on some businesses. We will be discussing how we can solve this issue and many more in our next webinar of this series titled API Multi-Region API Management with Rate Limiting. Next issue a business might face with the deployment that we use for our demo is related to publishing data to analytics. As you can see in the diagram, the micro gateways in the US region will publish analytics data to the analytics instance in the APAC region. This will result in bandwidth issues due to a high volume of data. One other issue that an organization might face is that the analytics instance might receive high traffic of data to be published, which might result in the analytics server to be crashed. In the above deployment, there are four micro gateways publishing to a single analytics node, and that too in a different region. We will be discussing how we can solve this analytics issue and more in our third and final webinar of this series titled Multi-Region API Management with Analytics. So that's all we have for this first webinar of the multi-region API management webinar series. So now we are happy to take some questions. So there is one question is been asked asking what is the key manager. So key manager will be a component where you will have the keys generated for in order to use a particular API, and those the key manager will send you the requested keys. And in this patterns we have discussed, in some patterns we have not included key manager, and the key manager is included in the all-in-one API manager instance. And the key manager is also used for key validation, where when you invoke an API using an OPAC token, a call will be going to the key manager and validate that particular token.
And there is also another question. The question is, what about active deployment will be preferred than active passive? So actually, in the active deployment, what happens is like both the data centers or both the nodes, if we consider as two nodes, so both the nodes will be active at a particular occasion. So what happens in the active passive deployment is that both nodes will not be active at a particular occasion, but only single node will be act as a active node. So in our case, like regarding to this multi-regional and multi-data center based deployments, if we think about that thing, so in an active deployment, all the traffic which comes to particular nodes will be load balanced to both nodes which are mentioned as active nodes. So but in the case of active passive deployment, what happens is like only the active node will receive traffic, but if when the active nodes gets down, only the passive node will receive the traffic. In the failover situation, once the active node gets down, it will receive the it will hand over the active state to the other passive node, so it will act as the passive node, active node at that moment. So basically the traffic partitioning is the key thing if we consider about what is the preference to use active versus active passive deployment.
So we have another question regarding analytics. It asks that can we analyze regional wise API usage using API analytics? Actually, we are unable, like it's not possible to analyze regional wise API usage using API analytics, but you can always partition that. Having two analytics node, you can have reduce the load or weightage. So we will be discussing on this in the third webinar session of this series in a descriptive mode. If you have any further questions, you can go ahead and post that questions in the question panel.
And there is another question. Can we externalize analytics to external Elasticsearch? So we assume this what you mean by Elasticsearch is some other analytics solution. So with the case of WS2 API manager, it is possible to, it is specifically designed and developed to use WS2 API manager analytics as the analytics solution, but required, it is possible to customize WS2 API manager. Actually, you have to write custom data publishers to use other custom analytic solutions. So in the short, as the short answer, it is possible, but you need customizations for that.
There's another question asking, what about SaaS API in different SaaS region? Can you indicate the same? So assuming that you are mentioning about SaaS API, so if you take a take a look at the API management solution, you will have to have the API in create the API in the API management solution, and then use the discussed scenarios in the slides and try to expose the API irrespective of what API it is. So seems like there are no more questions. So please feel free to download and try out our API management solution in the provided links. And please try to use the API management Slack channel if you have any questions. There's a community built around it. So our members in the Slack channel will try and respond to your questions. And the repository for the API management solution can be found in the Carbon API and GT repo and the product API repo. And for the demo materials, within a few days, we will upload the materials that we have used in the particular link given in the slide. So regarding the next sessions, we will have the second webinar of this webinar series on the 15th July. That will be based on multi-regional API management with rate limiting. And the last and final session of this webinar series will be on the 29th of July, which is based on multi-regional API management with analytics. So thank you everyone for joining this webinar. And you will get a small 30-second survey at the end. Please feel free to fill it and share your thoughts on it. And thank you very much and keep safe.